and welcome to the class today. Today we're going to be doing something brand new. We're going to be doing scraper boarding. It's a really fun medium to work with. You can get some really, really superb details with scraper boarding, and that makes them really, really impressive once they're framed and hanging up on the wall. So I think first things first, let me show you what is scraper boarding. Alright, so this here's a good example of scraper boarding. What it basically is you've got a board which has been coated with a plaster of Paris layer, and then over that there's it has another layer of Indian ink. So you then scratch out the Indian ink wherever you want your image to appear. So that in a nutshell is scraper boarding. So in order to do the scraper boarding, you do need some equipment. So let me show you how the equipment looks like. The first thing that you're going to need is a set of scrapers which you're going to use to scrape off the ink. So let's open this guy up. You get all sorts of different shapes and sizes. And because of the different shapes, you get all sorts of different marks that it makes on the board itself. Now, I must admit, I seldom use all of these guys. Alright, so this guy over here is your stock standard one. If you buy the box of scraper boards themselves, they often give you one of these guys with it for free. So it's just got a standard little sharp point with two flat edges on each side. So by using the point, you scratch out fine little lines, and by using the sides over here, you can scratch out nice wide, broad areas. This guy here, again, has got a sharp tip, and then a nice little rounded edge, which is lovely for when you're doing broad areas as well. This one over here, I must admit, I never use it. You can use it for, on the box it says you're supposed to, you'll be able to put this in your hand and then you twirl it. So, you know, fitting rocks and stuff like that, but for me, I've never used him, to be honest. Okay, this guy here, he looks very similar to your standard scraper, but his edges over here are just slightly rounded. And I must say that he's one of my favorites because you can get that nice sharp detail by using the tip. And then because of this rounded piece, it lets you do nice, lovely, wider, like let's say for example, maybe it's a very white area on the scraping that you're doing. So then this guy over here works well. Okay, this here is just an empty one. It's just to show you that these guys, you can buy the refills because they don't last very long. They blunt out quite quickly. So you can buy the refills and then you just pop them into your handle like that. And then this last one over here has just got little teeth like that, so it's nice for when you're doing grass and stuff like that. Again, it's not one that I use often. These two here I practically never use. That guy there I use a lot, this guy I use a lot, and on the odd occasion I'll use that rounded one over there, also just for lifting out very broad areas. Alright, so those are the scrapers themselves. The tool that I use the most is one of these X-Acto knives. Very sharp blade, so you do have to be super careful when you are working with this guy. All you're really interested in is using it for this tip over here. So it gives you nice thin little lines, and that allows you to get super fine detail with your work. Like I say, this guy is super sharp, so you have to be really careful when not in use, put his cover on and all those kind of things. What I also do when I've got an old blade, because these blades do, like I say, they do blunt out quite quickly. When I've got a blunt tip like this, obviously all that is still super sharp because you haven't even used it. So I use some masking tape. Just put that down there for a second. I'll use some masking tape. I'll turn it upside down like this. Then you take your blade and put it in there like that. And now you fold it over. few times. Like that. So what then that does is it encapsulates this blade. So you can now store it and use it for whatever craft project where you need the full cutting blade itself. Or if you're not going to be using it for anything else, you can now safely go and throw this in the dustbin. And you know, if you, when you're cleaning your dustbin, you're not going to go and cut your hands in the process. Alright, and then I've got a Sharpie as well. A lot of people use Indian ink. But I just use a Sharpie. So if I've made a mistake, I use the Sharpie to bring back the black. Alright, scissors is just for trimming things, for example, sandpaper. So the sandpaper, what that is used for is for making finer marks. I'll show you some examples shortly so you can see what each instrument, you could call it, does. And you'll see what the sandpaper does. You get different grits of sandpaper, in other words, how rough or how fine they are. I tend to use this, the fine one over here. And then I've also got some, these are just nail files. You get them at the dollar store, they're dirt cheap. Again, I'll buy the fine ones. You can also get the rough ones too. And that gives you all sorts of different textures. Now, what I use the scissors for is with the sandpaper, I cut it into a little, what shape is that, a trapezium. So I've got a nice flat area here to do large areas, plus I've got a little point which I can do fine areas. And that gives me all sorts of different textures and effects. Alright, and then the last thing is the masking tape. So what you'd sometimes do is, if you've got a picture, for example, like this, where you're not using the entire board. Can you see that? I've only used half the board. So then I can put some masking tape down over here, and that allows me to work over this, over the masking tape, without scratching in over this area over here, because I can still use that for another artwork. Alright, then you'd also need a ruler. So I've got two rulers. The first one is a plastic ruler, which I would use for doing just marks on the scraper board. For example, over here I've marked off the end of the artwork. So I put my ruler, the plastic one, over there so that I don't scratch the board itself. Then I've also got steel rulers, which you can now, if you need to, when this guy is done, you want to cut it. So then you'd use your steel ruler, and you would use a carpet knife, which looks like this. So you just use one of these guys, and that, to cut through there and trim it to the correct size that you want. Alrighty, then next up is I've got a very soft cloth. You can see I do keep it in a bag to make sure he stays as clean as possible. So it's a super, it's a really soft cloth. This is like almost like a chamois type of, it's the kind of material that you use for cleaning your computer screens and stuff like that. Again, I got these guys at the dollar store. They're dirt cheap. You'd buy them in a pack of five or so. Now what you use that for is you take your artwork that you're working on and you lay this over the area, because you don't want your hand touching here. The scraper boards you get are coated with different inks, so some of them make marks. I'm lucky, these ones that I buy don't leave marks, so I can physically put my hand on there without it leaving a mark. But it's because your skin has got a natural oily residue on it, and that oily residue remains on the board, and then it gives you those like dull and shiny marks and stuff. So you get a different shine on there. So if you're working, say, in this area over here, you'd lay your cloth down, and then you'd work, and then you lift up gently your cloth, and work. And again, this also just protects the area over here from scratches. Alrighty, and then obviously the good part, you need some scraper boards. Let's open this guy up over here. And you obviously get different sizes. So the size that I've got here is 229 by 305 millimeters. Beat me with a stick if I know what that is in inches, but it's roughly the size of an A4. Let's get an A4 sheet over here. You can see it's slightly bigger than an A4. Maybe we can measure it with a ruler to see if we can find our inches. So that's 9 by 12 inches. So it's a stock standard size. In other words, these guys come in the sizes that they come in are the same as your canvases. Right, so let me show you some of the different textures that you can get with the different tools. Okay, so let's start over here. So here, we basically just used our standard scraper tool and just used flicks. So let me do one or two and you can see. I'll add a few more grasses next to that guy. And then maybe there's a tall grass coming out here. So now as you're scraping, you'll also see that because this little, you're basically scraping off a little bit of that plaster of Paris, you do get this little residue. So every now and again, just blow it off. Alright, so here you have just used different tools. There is just scraping, so to get different tonal values and things, you can use a cross-hatching effect like this to get different tonal values. Here I've used more of a tapping kind of technique. That little tapping technique there is called stippling. Here I've showed you how to do some shadings. So again, it's all pretty much just like a cross-hatching effect. And here you can see how you can get lovely feather effects. This here is also scraping like that. But what's now cool about the scraper boarding is you can come over it again. And you can either use paint or you can use inks to add color in and then just scrape back into it to get your highlights and stuff back in. So here what I've done is I've just drawn a block. Same as this, just scraped it out. There I've covered it with watercolor paint. And there I've covered it up with a Sharpie. So you can see the difference. But now what happens is once this guy's finished, what you then do is you spray it with a fixative. And that evens out all these colors again. And needless to say, you're never going to do that. Cover up big pieces like that. That's not what you do. You'd cover up maybe small little pieces. So let's maybe show you this guy over here. So an example of where I would use the Sharpie in a case like this is I can come back in and just add that very dark little edging over there, or that fine little edge over there, just by the front of the eyeball. Or if you've maybe scraped a little piece, so let's say for example let's say maybe you're not happy with that guy over there, so then you can come back in with your Sharpie and just, you're just drawing over that tiny little area over there. And because it's so small, by the time that guy's done, you don't even notice it. And there we go. It was as easy as that. Can you see? You can't even see where you've made your mark. All right, so that's basically the tools that you need for scraper boarding. So it's not much tools. So let me show you what we're going to do for our... while I've got this, can you see, look at all this lovely detail. I'm going to zoom, see if I can zoom way in on this. Can you see that? Just look at this insane detail. It looks like you can see every single hair on this cat. That's pretty amazing, eh? Lovely. So what's nice about this is when you're standing far away from the artwork, it looks good. And the closer you come, it just looks better and better and better. See that? Pretty cool. Right, so what we're going to do today is we won't do something as intricate as this to get you into the swing of things. We're going to take this cat over here and then we're going to do a simplified version of it. So now that we've got an image to look at, when you looking for images to do your scraperboarding with, look for images that have got strong contrasts. In other words, nice dark darks and nice light lights. So there's another good example. Can you see you've got really good contrasts from all the way light through to dark? If you don't have them, this is the drawing or the photo from the previous cat that I did. Can you see all those really good contrasts from really bright all the way through to really dark? That's the secret to being able to do nice scraper boards. You need good contrasts. So what we're going to do is we're going to take this guy over here and we are going to simplify it. So what I've done is I turned it into a black and white on the computer. Then I just jazzed up the contrasts. And then when we're done, we'll have a beautiful scraper board like that, which we can frame and pop up on the wall. So what I have done is I've taken this guy on the computer and I've just inverted it so that I can print a second one to use for the transfer work, because we now need to get this guy onto our scratch board, and that just saved me a little bit of ink. Alright, so this is my dressmaker's carbon paper, so I'm going to put him down with the carbon side at the bottom. So we'll just pop him down there like that. And I have to make sure that everything doesn't move, because if you move stuff, then you're never going to get it aligned again. I'm going to just stick things down to the table for a minute. So we'll start off by sticking the paper down. Like that. Then I'll stick the board down as well. So this is just some clear tape, nothing fancy. There we go. So now I can flip this back and move my carbon paper around as much as I need to get my drawing work done. Now for the drawing work, there's not too much. What you're really looking for are the main outlines and stuff, no real details. So what I'll do is just add myself a few little direction lines. Now before I go too far, what I'll also do is I just double check that my marks are coming through. Otherwise you end up doing all this drawing work for nothing. So all these directions here, they tell you, they give you a good feel for where you need to, which direction you need to scratch in. That is pretty straight, so I'll just draw a straight line down there. right on that edge. So here's a few little suggestions of detail over here. I'm not going to bother with the whiskers either. They'll come here at the end. Okay, so let's make sure everything is transferred. Great. Move him down. Let's do this bottom bit. So this is quite smudgy over there. I quite like this idea of the belt buckle. So definitely we're going to pop him in. And here's just a few little marks down here. Nothing serious. Alright, so now the way I check myself is I'm going to take my carbon paper away. And I'm going to look at a specific spot, like say over here. And then I'm going to flip my page backwards and forwards. So I can see if that mark is over there. Like here, I've got this little line over here. I didn't get him in. There, I don't know where that guy. Don't know where he ends. I had a few lines in over there. So it looks quite random at the moment, doesn't it? But as you go along, you gradually start getting a better feel for it. So now, with that guy stuck down and that guy stuck down, you could leave it like this and work like that. But obviously, There could be times where you need to turn this guy around, so then you'd lose that. So the way to do it, if you do want to make sure that you can always check your lines again, is take two more pieces of tape. One go over here, and now you stick it right next to the edge, just on the table, but on the edge, like that. And like that. And if you do that on three edges, you'll be able to get this guy lined up perfectly every time. So pop him down there and maybe one more down this side. Then I've got two long edges that I can line this guy up again at any stage. So I'll just use my knife to lift that up and get rid of those two tapes. We're done with them now. You see, now what I can do is I can just flip this guy backwards and work with him. And like I said, at any stage I can go and just line those edges up there with the tape. And I put the tape over here. And voila, he's back to exactly where he was the first time. So then I could flip him back and do any more transferring if I ever need to. Okay, so when I start with something like this, what I do is I'm right-handed, so I'm going to start at the left and work my way this way. And I work at the top and I work my way down. It's just so that I'm not working over pieces that I've scratched. It doesn't really make a difference. You could start from the bottom and work your way up as well if that's easier for you. So what I'll do is I'll lay my cloth over here. Now you see I'm not rubbing it, I'm picking it up and I'm putting it down, because you don't want your class to now go and remove your marks that you've made, all your drawing work. And then I'll just start at a point. So for example, here's lots of stuff. So you know, when you're first starting, it's you've got to sort of just get a feel for what you need to do. So I tend to start with somewhere that's really light. So if I do muck up or whatever, it's in a light area. Alright, so let's start scratching. So I think I'll zoom in a bit. Like that. Alright, so I'm going to start with this bright area over here, and let's lay him in. So just little flicks. Yeah, it does seem to be going a little bit forward like that. And now what I'll do is, because I've stopped off the edge of the page, I'll just continue. Like that. Okay, and now I've got some curly ones running out around here somewhere. And now all I'm going to do is just look for getting the basic shape right. So what I'll check is how wide is he, and then his direction too. And then, needless to say, the lighter he is, the more scratches you've got to add in that area. Get the tonal value correct. Now when I flick, I'm flicking in the direction of the hair. So I start at the root of the hair, and then I'll flick outwards. Now you do also have to realize that the chance of you getting this looking exactly like the photo is pretty minimal. You can get it close. That's good enough. Let's see here, we just have a few little hidden ones. And they're all little short guys. Okay, here's some, and it's sort of going out of it's going darker to this side here, so I'm going to just use very short and very light scratches, because I want this to be it mustn't be as bright as that to get that fading out effect. Yeah, I can see these hairs are a lot longer, so I'm going to start using longer flicks as well. Again, check your directions though. The hairs are going to go generally in one direction, but each one will have his own little direction that he heads in. Quite a lot. Again, the guys stop at different lengths and different widths, and you also find that some of these hairs are clumping together like that. So you've got these little clumps of hairs. Okay, and we've got some here short guys over here. Here at the end, it's lighter, so I'm going to use very light touch just to get a darker tonal value, so you're not scratching off quite as much of the ink as normal. Here it goes lighter, so I add more scratches. Here things start tying up again. As you can see over here, we've got little areas where it's lighter and where it's darker. Less scratches and more scratches. So like here in this area, yeah, it's a little bit darker there, right? So we've got this nice, some bright guys coming down there, so scratch in that light guy, and that'll remind me where he ends. And then we've got some of these lighter guys coming in over here, and the directions are changing. These guys are in sun, so I've got to add more flicks to get that lighter over there. That goes lighter, some more scratches over there. There's something really bright. I think that is the tip of his ear at the back. Yeah, it looks like the tip of his ear. Hey, so I think I'll round that off there and then we just flick it in. So I'm scratching all the ink away over here and then just flicking it inwards to tie in with the rest of the hairs. Yeah, this bright guy's come down a little bit further. Right, so from here, there's quite a bit of lots of hair, yeah. Can see lots of hair, but they're not that bright. So you're just gonna have to use your judgment in this area. With light flicks. Just enough to get you that correct tonal value. Over here, short little flicks. And then they tie up over here. And here we've got almost a hard edge over there. So I think what I'm going to do is just first work in this edge. Just so now I've got it. All the time I'm looking at those directions. Make sure I get them right. It's quite bright in that area there. So now we're heading towards full on sunlight here, eh? And I take a look at the hairs here on this edge. They're all doing their own little thing. Some are going this way, some are going that way. Guys are all going in that direction. So I'll often just, like I'm doing now, just add a few little guys to get me a feel. So these guys start here, so they're going this way, and then they curl that way. So you can't do S's, so you do a flick this way, and then a flick that way. That's how you get them to tie into each other and look like one continuous. Here. So there we do have lots of hairs there. all the while as I'm flicking them out, I'm being careful to make sure that I get the shape as accurate as what I can. Yeah, it's quite bright. Yeah, it's quite bright, so lots of flicks in this area. Gradually keep building it up. Then adjust your shape as you go along. Lighter over here, there on that eyebrow. Now I'm working in that little dark area there, so I'm just avoiding that. That's all. Okay, roughen up that end over there. Just like that, to get the hairs to look like they're each one's doing their own thing, so you get a few little guys heading in their own direction. Alright, so let's say for example, like in this area here, you can see it's a little bit too dark. So then just take your Sharpie. And just dull down most of the lines in that area there. And then leave your Sharpie to dry. We'll come back to that. Alright, let's work on this. Little bridge of the nose piece. See, I can just see I'm a little bit off for my. Let me just a little bit straight off, but a little bit too rough at the moment. That's fine. Just do those little fine adjustments as you go along. in the beginning, it's really difficult to see all those little changes in tonal value and stuff, because you've just got black. But as you go along, it becomes easier and easier to spot. Alright, so all the way down here, it's roughly straight. But it's not a solid line, it's all little tiny hairs there. So short little flicks. So check your directions very carefully here. It's almost like a 45 degree there. Take your time. Don't rush it. Take your time. Keep working on getting those directions right. Okay, so over here on this nose piece, it's so short that is practically solid. But I'm still not going to do it solid. I'm scratching it with short little flicks. Because I still want it to look like hair. So when the person comes and looks really close to this artwork, they'll still see those tiny little hairs. Okay, let's continue working down this area here. Now here you have to be careful, these directions are changing a little bit. So here what I suggest you do is start off too short. And then you'll gradually lengthen them up. But each flick that you do starts here at the root, a flick out. And that's going to give you that gradual little shading there. So some are going to go all the way across, very gentle. Like that. And then I'm doing a little bit longer ones, a little bit shorter ones rather. And then even shorter ones. And can you see what's happening? It's forming a shading there. Right, so these guys will flick a few in that way. Same thing. Some longer, some shorter. And that's going to give me my shading that I need. And then you'll just continue that until you see that you're happy with the tonal value. Alright, so let's start getting this shape here a little bit more accurate. Mine's maybe a little bit too high, eh? Well, that's not a problem. Let's move him down. Alright, so those guys there have dried now already. You just come back in and you add one or two flicks back. Obviously we needed less this time. There you go, sorted. Easy peasy. Right, we'll give that there another second just to dry. That little bit longer. Let's maybe start working on this piece over here. think what I marked there was that brightest area. Take that down there just a little bit too far. And the same over there. Alright, so we're done. That guy there is dry, so let's continue with him. Just like that. Okay, this here should be dry, so let's work that guy in, refine him a little bit. So this here can still go a little bit broader. And it'll go a little bit brighter too. So now I'm actually scratching downwards just to make sure that there's no ink left in that area. There's a bit of a shading, so I'm just adding a few more little lines there. Down here, these two guys tie in with each other. that. I'll stick with the flicking motion because I know it is here. So we'll use the same motion all the way along. Really short little stabs and jabs now at the moment though. Right, so over here we've got this little bright area here where the whiskers come out. Work that in, and we've got this area over here also where the whiskers are coming out. So again, I'm just looking at those directions and I'm making sure I get them right. Total value may not be spot on yet. Now in between here, I know that there is hair, so I'm just going to add a few little lines and stuff just to suggest them. Okay, let's get this guy over here as broad as he needs to be. I suppose you can hear every now and again I am blowing on the board just to get rid of all those little shavings and scrapings and things. Okay, this is his nose, so it's quite smooth there, so I'm going to make sure I get a nice sharp little line there, sharp edge. It does seem to have a little bump over there. So let's see if we can work that in. I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to curl that up. And back in again. And then we can carefully cool this guy out a little bit more. Just to give us that bump there too. Okay, make sure there's no ink left in that area. Get it nice and clean. Now I'm not turning my board, but you're welcome to turn yours. Keep scratching in this area here until we get that width correct. Seems to be roughly like that. Alright, so here, short here, so again, just short little, very short little stabbing motion almost. get that right. Here's a few little flicks over here. Just short ones, just to suggest those hairs. Okay, now here you have to look really carefully because you've got lots of changes of direction happening. As these little hairs go around the face. And we can see them. If you look on your reference photo, you'll see you can see them, so you've got to be really careful to get them right. And to make sure that you can still see your hairs. Like a monkey at the moment, eh? Right, so I think what I'm going to do is I'm going to continue all the way down here with this chin. Let's get that little silhouette done there, because that's going to help us judge all these other little fiddly details and stuff in between. Can you see how the direction of the hairs have changed? These guys are a bit longer. And then here they become darker, so I'll have to go further apart. Longer flicks and shorter flicks. Here they're getting shorter again, so I've got to use shorter flicks. See, sometimes I'm going over the same spot to make sure that I get longer and shorter hairs and lighter and darker hairs. There's little dabs and dashes and things over here. So I'm just suggesting them. I'm not trying to get them exact. It's just too difficult to do that. And so here, these guys are all really short. So to shorten them, because you've now got all these little flicks, right? So to shorten them, I'm actually going in the opposite direction. So almost like a bit of a cross-hatching. And that'll make sure that they appear nice and short. And you can even do that over here as well a little bit. In this area here. Just in the opposite direction, 90 degrees. And that just helps to make them appear shorter. Yeah, I think this guy can go up a little bit further. And we've got the same thing happening around here. Just a whole bunch of little lines. So what we're trying to do is just suggest that detail. Okay, and I'll shorten them as well, just by going cross-hatching. And I'm just scratching it more and less places just to get the tonal values right. So I'll scratch over the same place a few times. All the while I'm also just adjusting the positions and the shapes of all these main little highlights and things, just adjusting them to make sure I get them closer to where they need to be. So luckily nobody's ever going to see your final artwork and the picture next to each other, unless you show them, of course. But nobody's going to see them together. So if you don't get this 100% right, or something is a little bit off and so on, it doesn't really matter. It really doesn't matter. I think I'll add just a few little extra flicks in that area over there. Right, and that there just seems to end in a little bit of a line. So I'll just add a few little extra guys over there. Just a few shorter and longer ones. Just to hide that line. Alright, so now around here there's also still a few little dabs and dashes and things. As the light curls away from the face, you're going to get that less and less detail. Okay, and over here this can come down a little bit. A little bit further there. That gives that curling around for the eye socket. Okay, let's zoom out again. Let's see what he looks like. Alright, so now that you've got quite a way down the road, what you want to do is just stand back and then check that you've got everything filled up enough and that you've got enough contrasts and tonal values, that you've built them up far enough. For example, over here, I can see I can still add a few more very light little flicks just to fill up those hairs a little bit further. So I'm not pressing hard, absolutely gentle. And over here again as well, I've got little areas where it's lighter, so I think I'm going to use this guy, because he'll lift out a little bit broader lines, and that'll just allow me to get there quicker. So you'd have to be careful when you're using this guy to very quickly lift out too much with him, and that's why I prefer to use the knife 90% of the time. Because I've got more control over the knife. Okay, and then over here. Here I've also got a few little loose guys coming down this way. So let's pop them in too. Adding a little bit more sun there, that area, just to help us to get that different contrasts over there. Yeah, that should be good. Okay, here we can work on that tie in there a little bit more. Maybe Maybe there's a hair going the wrong way. And we just make that fade out just a little bit slower today. Okay, let's give him a quick wipe in that area. Just to get rid of any lines that we've got. And it seems like here we can also go a little bit slower on that fading out, eh? So let's add a few more dabs and dashes and things over here. There's some guys over here. It may look like just a few little dabs and dots to you, but to your brain, that's the giving you the shape of the face. So by adding in just these few little dabs and dashes, that's adding in that curling and stuff, the turning of the face. There's just a tad too dark, so let's kill it. Wonderful. Let's move down. And let's go and do this area over here. Alright, so over here, can you see it's not really those sharp edges and things anymore, hey? So now I'm not going to use the knife anymore. I'm going to use this one with that curved blade. And when I work with it, I'm going to work with it on this round piece. And when I press, I'm going to apply absolutely almost zero pressure. Because what I want to do is, I want to just lift out very light little bits of ink. Very, very light. Don't panic too much if you do end up getting it a little bit too light. Really slow. All you're doing is you're just gradually scratching off a nice little layer of ink at a time. As you're sketching like this, what you're trying to do is just build up that almost like a bit of a smoky kind of a look. So look for where it's lighter and where it's darker, with different tonal values. And now where it's lighter, you obviously going to scratch off a little bit more, you're going to scratch in that area a little bit longer. Now I'm holding this scraper absolutely feather light. There's quite frankly no pressure, absolutely no pressure at all. If I hold it any lighter, it's going to fall out my hand. And as you can see, you have to be patient when you're doing this as well. Because you're taking off such thin little layers of ink at a time. Now to help get that bit of a smoky out of focus effect, can you see I'm working in different directions as well, not just in one direction. If you've gone too dark in areas, you know what to do. So we do have a few little distinct hairs over there, so I'm working them in. Some are lighter and some are darker. Now if you had to come and look at this, you'll see that it's actually a super fine, almost like a bit of a cross hatch. But like literally using a magnifying glass to see it. Because it's so fine. Seem to have a bit of a tie-in, maybe just one or two little light guys there just to tie that up. Tie that together. And then here, just to join those guys up. Like that. Alright, so again over here it's very, very fine. So I think we can go back to the knife. So I'm going to start off just with the lightest little scratches, almost nothing. course I'll scratch a little bit more in that area. So don't try and make this perfect. All we need to do here is get enough to just suggest. That this is a belt. So what you want to be doing is just getting in those basic, the most basic shapes. I almost want to say get in the essentials. Whatever makes this thing look like a belt or a, it's not quite a belt, is it? What do you call it? Just little dabs and taps and scratches and things. That's all you need. Now take a look like this guy. See, you do have to look quite fine. For example, this guy here, he starts off broadish and then he goes thinner and thinner. So you do have to look quite careful to get those guys right. See, there is a line that I actually forgot. Can you see that? Luckily we have enough lines in to judge him. But if you can't, you've got all your stuff back in place. Just line your sketch board back up again. And make him, and mark him. I'm literally just estimating these guys. I'm really not trying to get anything perfect here. Need to do is just get everything more or less in the right place, and then we A for away. See, I'm just using little taps and things. There was another line that I forgot. Okay, now see, this line isn't solid. So we're going to just put it in with little taps. Basically thousands of little dots. All these funny little marks and things, all just little tabs, dashes and scratches. So just decide, do you need to use dots? Or do you need to use scratches? There's a nice little bright area, hey? I'm not going to try and put in any shading over there. You can if you want to, you're just going to use a horde of dots. Oh, why not? Doesn't seem like it's going to take too long. So I'm just using that absolute tip. Now what this is going to do is just gradually build up those tonal values. You just got to keep checking the tonal value. Have you tapped enough in that area? Or not? When you're doing this kind of work, you really need to be patient. I'm also not holding the knife, it's actually sort of bouncing around in my hand as I'm tapping. So I'm not stabbing this paper, I don't want to kill the paper. That's good enough. A little bit over here. So the kid's brighter, so I'm tapping there a bit longer. Now there's also nothing stopping you from using cross-hatching. Just very fine cross-hatching. You decide what's better for you. There we go, that should give us the rounding that we need there. Yeah, seems like that can go just a touch broader over there. So I'll turn this area just all. And here we've got some more stitching. Not quite as bright, so I'm using just little, tiny little stabs and things. Here's also a little bit over here. Some of those guys are quite bright. And others are less. So I'm going to use just a combination of scratching and tapping. Alrighty, so we are so close to finished. Okay, so again here we're back to this misty feeling again. So very gentle. Absolutely take your time here. You see, we've got that little dark line there. That helps also just to tell your eye that the buckle has got thickness. So work really hard to get that in. And here, it's really quite far away from the focal point, so I'm not gonna, also just not going to panic to get it perfect or anything like that. It's really not necessary. Nobody's even gonna look here. And if they do look here, they're gonna look at that belt buckle. Can't think of what you call it because it's not a chain. It's a leash. So can you see? I'm just building up this little smoky, out of focusy kind of effect here. It's absolutely no rush, especially because you've worked so hard. To get the rest looking good, I think in here I have to be careful. There's a little, see, there's another edge of that buckle over there that I didn't get in. So just pop that over there. Yeah, it can get a little bit thicker than that. Just a little bit broader, a few little, almost just using a little circular effect there, or circular emotion, to broaden that up. Right, so here, we can lift away quite a bit, so I'm using the side there. Side of this rounded scraper. Now I'm back to using the, still using the side and the tip sometimes, just to get back to a hair effect. Right, softly here to get smoky effect. Here's a bit more of a few more smoky effects and things going on here. All very out of focus stuff, so. Work really gentle and then fade it out as it comes around this way. Softer and softer. See how long it takes to build up this smoky effect? It's just, unfortunately, there's no way to rush it. Alright, so let's get a few more solid guys in over here to suggest some of those here. I'm just pressing a little bit harder and going over the same spot a few times. To give me those hairs, that's all. Okay, it's back to soft again. Alright. Let's zoom out and see where we're at. Alrighty, so there's only one thing left to do, and that's all the whiskers. Alright, so I'm going to use this guy because he does make a little bit broader marks. So when you put in these whiskers, you have to be pretty confident. Just put them in. And it just flicks. And if you don't get them 100% the same as the... as on the picture, that's just fine. Nobody's ever going to know. Now what's important here is that you see each one of these guys literally do their own thing. So although they're generally going in the same direction, and if one now really does fluff up, then just use your Sharpie to kill him and do him again. Like I could use a few more in this area here, hey. One or two that are coming out there from the back. And there's still some over here. Longer ones, thinner ones, some guys curling this way, one or two short ones even curling that way. Yeah, that seems about equal, eh? Let's put one long one, just because we can. Alrighty, there we go. Yeah, I'm pretty happy with that. That looks just like the original.